Hi, this is Russell Davis for ESCtoday.com. We are at the Eurobus with a wonderful Kit Rolf, lead singer of Bell and the Devotions. Well, you're Bell of the Bell of Devotions.
I am, yeah.
Yeah. So it's wonderful to see you again. I mean, 1984, you represented the UK in Eurovision Song Contest.
This is true.
So you're making a reappearance in the Eurovision scene.
Yeah, absolutely. I was invited to come here by Paul, and I was honoured and privileged to be asked, and I've just had the most fantastic, amazing day. This has been a wonderful time. Everybody has been so amazing, and Hera Bjork, of course, is fantastic, charismatic, brilliant singer. We've just had such fun.
And you had a wonderful reception when you sang Love Games again. The fans loved it. Is that song something special to you?
Of course, yeah. And I'd kept the jacket all these years, and when I brought the jacket out, people recognised it and everything, yeah. It was a very iconic jacket, designed especially for the show, you know, for the Eurovision show in 1984.
It was lime green and black, very
That's
distinctive,
right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Spiky blonde hair.
Yeah.
Were you happy with that look at that time?
Absolutely. It was perfect. Perfect for the time, perfect for me and the girls, perfect.
Mm-hmm. And were you expecting to win Song for Europe back in 84? Was it a big surprise? Because it was a big TV show then. It was more high profile.
The Song for Europe show was the show as far as England went, obviously. And we were not tipped to win it. We knew we had a great song, a great act, a great image. But for some reason, we didn't have the vibes. We didn't have the vibes or the pressure that we were tipped to win it. And it was a bit of a surprise because one or two other acts were tipped to win and pressure was off us. And then it didn't just win, it swept the board with all the voting.
And if I remember the time, you had a lot of media attention, three attractive young ladies. The tabloids loved you. Do you remember the media attention? How was that?
We just did so much. We did so many photo shoots, and we were invited into London salons to have photo shoots in fabulous clothes and things like that. And fantastic clothes and all that. It was if let's use this group to model these clothes for the tabloid press, and we all loved it. It was great.
And how was it in Luxembourg for the Eurovision Song Contest?
Well, it was lovely. It was absolutely lovely. But we must have been at the bottom of the list for getting a hotel, because we were expecting something like the Sheraton Hotel or something, you know. And we got this sort of tiny little pension place. It was so weird. It was very weird and very basic. And I'll never forget the ensuite facilities behind the curtain. But so it was a bit basic, but we had a lot of fun, you know.
Mm-hmm. And how were the nerves having to perform in front of millions of people on the night and the build-up and the pressure?
Well, it's pretty scary to do that. I think most people are going to feel it's pretty scary performing in front of millions on live TV. But, of course, what gets you through is the fact that you've rehearsed so much. And when you've rehearsed everything so much, then you just do it. Yeah. It's not a problem.
Now, it was the early 80s, a couple of weeks before the English supporters had hit Luxembourg and did a lot of damage.
Yeah.
And you were booed off stage after performance. Yeah. And it was accredited to the fact that there'd been a lot of trouble with English fans. Yeah. Was that the reason you feel that you were booed off?
It is a strange situation, because it seemed to be a done thing that people thought it was because of the football hooliganism that there was some antagonism. And I'm sure it's true. Because, you know, there's a lot of political voting with countries and all that sort of thing. I'm sure it's true as far as the voting went, yeah. The actual boos, I was told from somebody who should know, I can't remember who, but somebody who was in a position to know, that the boos came from the press enclosure. And we had some strange interviews with some of the European press where they did not like what we were doing. They didn't like our image, and they didn't like the fact that we were doing a song that was evocative of the Tamla Motown era and the Diana Ross and Supremes thing. Nowadays, you'd say, well, this is a kind of a tribute to that, you know, whole thing, period and everything. Then it was just, you're just ripping it off. That was the attitude was we were ripping off. At times we were even accused of the song was plagiarised, you know, but it wasn't, you see. It was just similar of types of many of those songs. Where did our love go? Anything like that. But it wasn't ripped off as such, but we had some antagonism from that, and I was told that the boos came from the press enclosure. Yeah.
Do you watch the contest back? Have you seen it since?
I haven't watched it for a long, long time. I don't like... I can't say I don't like watching myself. I do... I'm quite happy to watch myself in certain situations. But having watched myself once or twice, I don't usually feel the need to watch myself anymore. And sometimes... sometimes then I do actually get shy about watching myself back on TV things, and I don't do it much, you know. I've put aside videos that I think, yeah, that's great. I'll watch that anytime or show it to anybody. And others I think, oh, I'm not so sure about that, you know.
Do you remember Diggaloo Diggalay?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You like the song?
No. But all I remember was that when they did the reprise of the song at the end, one of the little blonde boys fell off the back of the stage. I remember that. He just fell off the back.